Welcome back to my channel. I'm Farah and in today's video, we're gonna talk about web cache deception. Before we get in this video, I want to tell you that this video is sponsored by Integrity. Integrity is a bug bounty platform that has a lot of European programs, but you can still participate in them even if you're outside Europe. Integrity also gives back a lot to the community in the form of articles and regular Twitter posts, so definitely give them a follow. And if you're interested, then you can sign up on Integrity using my link. And if you want to know more about web cache deception, then please continue watching. So this video is highly inspired by Omar Gill's research on the topic. And if you want to dive deeper on this topic, I highly recommend you give his white paper a read. I'm going to link it down below in the description along with a couple of other resources, so you can check those out too. So what is a cache? Developers configure web caching functionalities to their application, which stores files that are frequently requested by users. So when a user requests one of those files, it is served directly from the cache, and there's no need for the server to deal with each request over and over again. So this helps in reducing load for the server and also helps users get their content faster. So which files are cached and which aren't? According to best practices, files that are cached are usually public, static, and don't contain any sensitive information. For example, style sheets, scripts, and images. And files that contain sensitive information or information that's specific to only one user, like account details, wallet information, and information of previous orders, are not cached. There are many ways to implement cache, but for this video, we will use the Varnish reverse proxy. But this attack can also work with different CDNs and as well as load balancers. So before we get into this attack, we're just going to go to our lab first to see what we're working with. So as you can see, I have my lab right here, and this is a basic login page. So I'm going to enter my username and password and login. And as you can see, I've reached a profile page where I have my account settings like user ID, name, email, phone, and city, and these would be considered as sensitive details. So I'm just gonna look at this request in burp now. I'm gonna forward this to repeater, and let me maximize and send this request. And you will notice the Varnish headers in the response. And let's look at the age header. The age header contains a value which specifies how long it has been since the last cache entry for that path. And you can see that even though I'm sending it again and again, the age remains zero, which indicates that this page is not being cached, and that's probably because it contains sensitive information. So we know that profile.php is not being cached, but what happens if we request a URL like profile.php/nonexistent.css, where nonexistent.css is a non-existent file? Depending on the server's technology and configuration, it could be possible that the non-existent path is ignored and the response that is returned is for the profile.php page, while the URL in the browser still remains profile.php/nonexistent.css. So let's look at our lab now to get a more clear understanding of this. So as you can see, I have my profile.php page over here and it has all my account details. I'm going to navigate to nonexistent.css, and as you can see, it's the same page with profile.php's content, while the URL in the browser is profile.php/nonexistent.css. So why is this relevant here? As I mentioned earlier, most caches are configured to cache all public and static files that have extensions like .css, .js, .png, and other similar extensions. So when we request a URL like profile.php/nonexistent.css and it returns the content of profile.php, what happens is that the cache sees the .css extension at the end and caches it because of its configuration, while the content of the URL contains sensitive private information. So let's look at a demo for this. So I have my profile.php page over here, and I'm going to go to nonexistent.css, and when I load it, I can see that I have the same content. So let me intercept this request on burp now. So I'm going to intercept and load. Let me send this to repeater and maximize. So when I send this request, you can see that the age has a value of 17 now, which indicates that the page has been cached since the first time we requested it. And it keeps increasing as we send multiple requests. This confirms that the page is being cached. And let me go down. It has my sensitive information like my name. It also has my email. And this page should ideally not be cached, but it is. So how can we exploit this? An attacker can exploit this by sending a URL with the non-existent path to the victim and assuming that the victim is logged into their account. The page containing the victim's profile information gets cached and the attacker has to simply request the URL in order to get the victim's information. So let's look at an attacker's exploitation of this. So you can see that the URL right now is profile.php/nonexistent.css. I'm going to load it and then I will copy it and open a private window. I'm going to paste it over here and load it. And as you can see that the profile information shows up even on the private window without logging in. So to summarize, there are two most important conditions that need to be met for this to be considered a vulnerability. First, when requesting a URL like profile.php/nonexistent.css, it should return the content of profile.php. And the second condition is that web caches should decide whether to cache or not cache a file based on their extension. So if you're interested in creating your own lab and practicing this attack yourself, all you have to do is use a basic login page based in PHP and integrate it with a Varnish cache. And I'm going to leave a link down below for instructions on how you can do that. Once you're done with that, you have to edit your default.vcl file and add this configuration to it, which basically instructs the cache to cache or not cache the file based on their extension. And that's all I have for this video. I hope you learned something new. And if you did, then like this video and subscribe to my channel because I'm going to be posting videos like this a lot more often. And thank you for watching. Bye.